Hello, future engineers, welcome to my YouTube channel. If you're still new to my channel and you like what I'm doing, please don't forget to subscribe and share my videos to your friends and to your friends' friends. That's the only way you can help me promote my channel and to keep me going, refreshed, and inspired. And I'm very willing to share my knowledge, especially topics in civil engineering, for your benefit. Okay, let us formalize stress setup point. So it requires introduction of a sign convention, which we will explain and which I explain and discuss here. And it also needs noting of subscripts for stress components. Then we proceed to first reference planes, where these stresses or component of stresses are to be calculated based on these reference planes. We take note that in chapter 1, stresses acting at a point depend on the orientation of the reference plane. And if the general body has the following shapes here, like this, then the stress components at O, by passing through this plane AA, can be found by computing the normal and the shearing stress through point O, normal to plane A, and tangential to plane AA. We can do that. Of course, we then compute normal stresses through same point O, but through plane BB. We expect different results because of different orientation, though the planes pass through a common point O. The reason for that is the resultant is different. The resultant force through plane AA, through point O on plane AA, will be different from the resultant force through the same point O but through plane BB. So in this figure, part A is the body in coplanar equilibrium, part B stresses acting on plane AA at point O, then stresses acting on plane BB at point O. We can compute the stress components through a specific point and with different planes. So usually it is not practical to compute stresses acting on an arbitrary chosen planes because the available formulas are limited. So choosing planes because of the formulas give stresses on certain planes only. For bending, for example, MC over I, we only have formulas in computing stresses normal to the cross-sectional area of the section. And for shearing stress, VQ over IB, that's also for the tangential component, tangent to the cross-section. And for torsion, shear stress equals torque rho over J for shafts applied to cross-sectional areas and longitudinal or complementary planes. We don't have idea yet on planes through the same point but oblique from the cross-sectional areas or longitudinal planes of the cross-section. So we need to have additional tool, mathematical tool, by the transformation equations in order to locate those planes where critical stresses, when you say critical stresses, maximum, minimum values for normal stresses and shearing stresses occur. which is very important because those are the critical sections and used in designing the structural member. So as an illustration, remember that if this is the shaft, we have an element there. These types of loading for normal stress, normal to the cross-sectional area and tangential to the area, can be found only with respect to this planes or orientation. But it is limited when we want to find the location of the critical section. So the computed values of normal and shear stress are not the maximum values. The maximum values of these stresses occur on planes that are inclined to the sides of the elements, as already mentioned. The maximum values of these stress components are important to design. So let us examine how these stress components at a point vary with the orientation of the reference planes by introducing an angle with these reference planes so that we can develop mathematical equations, which we call transformation equations, in order to locate planes where critical stresses occur. We now proceed to the discussion on state of stress at a point and define it. The state of stress at a point is defined by the stress components acting on the sides of a differential volume element that encloses that point. So that's the definition. From there, knowing the state of stress at a point, we can compute stress components that act on any plane passing through that point, including the maximum values of these stress components and the planes where they occur, after we derive the what we call transformation equations. But as of the moment, without the transformation equations, we can only compute the stress components on any angle from the reference plane, from this state of stress at a point, without knowing yet the location of the critical stresses or the maximum normal, maximum and minimum normal stresses, as well as the maximum shearing stress. And before we proceed, it is important to have sign convention and subscript notation. So the sign convention considers a tensile normal stress as positive and compressive stress as negative, which we already knew before. So let's just repeat it here so that we will be guided in our discussion. So this is the X phase and the outward flow. This is tensile, so this is positive because the normal stress is towards the positive X direction. This is also tensile, sigma Y. This is also tensile, sigma Y, in the negative direction. In other words, these directions are all positive, including the shear stress. So this sign convention for shear stress will also be discussed here. The single subscript on the normal stress indicates the phase of which it acts. The first subscript on shear stress indicates the phase on which it acts. The second subscript shows the direction of the stress. So that's why, because this shear stress acts on the X phase and towards the second subscript coordinate axis, towards the Y axis, therefore this shear stress is positive. And this shear stress is also positive because it acts on the Y phase, the first subscript here, and the stress is outward in the positive direction, and the second subscript is the coordinate axis in the positive direction. So that's also positive. The first subscript here is the X phase in the negative direction, and it is directed also in the negative Y direction. That's why this is a positive shear stress. This is also positive because it is in the negative Y direction. The outward normal is in the negative direction, and the second subscript is also in the negative direction. So if the first and the second subscripts match negative negative direction, negative phase, then negative direction, then they are considered positive. Opposite to this direction should be negative shear stress, shearing stress. So I hope that you can remember the sign convention for, especially for shearing stresses. For normal stresses, it's understood as long as it is a tensile away from the face, then positive, tensile, compressive, negative. The magnitudes of shear stresses on complementary planes are equal. So that is tau xy is equal to tau yx. Remember in chapter 1. In a triaxial stress, state of stress, its face of an element is generally subject to three stress components: a normal stress, two shear stresses, tau xy, tau xz components as shown in this figure here. In biaxial, then sigma z would be zero, tau zy would be zero, and tau zx would be zero for biaxial stress, state of stress. So in this case, this is biaxial state of stress. For triaxial, it is also applicable, and take note of the stresses, stress components, if the state of stress is triaxial. Two shearing stresses and one normal stress for triaxial state of stress. Since the free body diagram method is limited, it can only compute stress components through a point and with different planes or angle. It cannot yet determine the location of maximum or critical stresses, or planes where critical stresses are found, the maximum, minimum normal stresses, and the maximum shearing stress. So there's a need to derive or develop transformation equations for plane stress. So the state of stress at a point is represented by the stresses that act on the mutually perpendicular faces of a volume element enclosing the point. The mathematical relationships that describe this variation are called the transformation equations for stress, which we are about to derive here. So let's now have the transformation equations, and you have to listen very carefully so that the derivation of formulas can be easily developed by the free body diagram method. So this is the original state of stress, assuming all the normal and the shearing stresses are positive. And we want to transform this state of stress on this differential volume to state of stress normal and tangential to this plane AA here. So this is the equivalent state of stress now, denoted by sigma x prime or sigma normal and tau x prime y prime, which is now the axis or shear stress on this area here through plane AA and through the same point, of course, because this is a point, remember. And the angle it makes with the reference axis x is theta, and theta is positive in the counterclockwise direction as shown. Then we have the free body diagram here on this part. These are now the sigma x prime and tau x prime y prime, which is also called sigma normal or normal stress, normal to plane AA and tangential to shear stress, which is tangential to plane AA. As our guide, we have here the normal axis and the tangential axis here. The area on this inclined face is denoted by dA. You can set dA equal to 1 for simplicity. Therefore, from these stresses here, they are now forces, differential forces on this free body diagram, because they are now multiplied by the area of the face on which these stresses act. So for instance, sigma x prime times the area of plane AA, dA becomes a differential force, differential normal force, and tau x prime y prime times dA becomes a differential shearing force in that direction. So this is dA, hypotenuse cosine of this angle, which is theta. So this is tau xy, shear stress xy, originally tau xy, then times dA cosine theta, it becomes a differential shearing force. And for this one, this is sigma x dA cosine theta. Sigma x dA cosine theta. And this is tau xy dA. dA sine theta, because this is hypotenuse dA sine of theta. While this is sigma y times the area, which is dA sine theta. So that summation forces normal equals zero. So we have sigma x prime dA, which is positive. Of course, tau x prime y prime dA has no component in that direction. Then minus, this is sigma x dA cosine theta, then its component along the normal is multiplied further by the cosine of this angle, which is also theta. So minus sigma x dA cosine theta times cosine theta, that's the component of this leftward differential normal force along the normal in the negative direction, because this is also theta. Then the component of this tau xy dA cosine theta is this component here, which is tau xy dA cosine theta times sine of theta. So minus tau xy dA cosine theta times sine theta, the normal component of this force, of this shearing force, shearing differential force, is this component in the negative direction. So it is tau xy dA cosine theta times sine theta minus the normal component of this differential normal force sigma y dA sine theta, then another sine theta, because this is theta also. So this component in the negative normal direction is sigma y dA sine theta times sine theta minus let's have this first. This component is tau xy minus tau xy dA. The component of this shearing, differential shearing force, is this force in the negative normal direction. So we copy tau xy dA sine theta, then times the cosine of this angle, which is also theta. Then finally, the normal component of sigma y dA sine theta is multiplied by sine of theta, because this component is in the negative normal direction and this angle is theta. So it is opposite to theta, so that's why minus sigma y dA sine theta times sine theta. So simplifying and transposing all these terms to the right except sigma x prime, then we have sigma x prime equals sigma x cosine square theta after we cancel out dA. By the way, dA is common to all terms. Then plus sigma y sine square theta. These two terms become positive to the right and we can combine them because they are like terms. So 2 times tau xy sine theta cosine theta, this middle two terms. So let's call that equation A. So similarly, summation forces tangential equals zero. So we have tau x prime y prime dA. Then this has no component in that direction. This is sigma x dA cosine theta. Its tangential component is upward. So plus sigma x dA cosine theta times sine theta. So sigma x dA cosine theta times sine theta, because this is theta. Then minus, the component of this is tau xy dA cosine theta times cosine theta. It is in the negative direction. So minus this component here of this force is in this direction. So minus tau xy dA cosine theta times cosine theta. Then the tangential component of this is tau xy dA sine theta times sine theta, and it is positive. It is pointing in the positive tangential direction. So plus tau xy dA sine theta times sine theta, because this is theta also. Then lastly, for the tangential component of sigma y dA sine theta, it is minus because it is in that direction. And we multiply it by this term here is multiplied by cosine theta. So minus sigma y dA sine theta times cosine of theta equals zero. So transposing everything to the right and canceling out dA, which is common, so tau x prime y prime equals negative sigma x sine theta cosine theta plus tau xy cosine squared theta minus sine squared theta, then plus sigma y sine theta cosine theta. So simplifying further, tau x prime y prime is equal to quantity negative of negative sigma x minus sigma y close sine theta cosine theta plus tau xy quantity cosine squared theta minus sine squared theta. So call that equation B. Then we take note that cosine of theta plus 90 degrees from trigonometry is cos cos minus sin sin. So cosine theta cosine 90, cosine 90 is 0, so 0. Plus sin sin sine theta sine 90. Cos cos minus sin sin, so minus sine theta sine 90. Since sine 90 is 1, then negative sine, the result would be negative sine theta times 1, so or negative sine of 90. While sine theta plus 90 is sin cos plus cosine. Sine theta cosine 90, cosine 90 is 0, so 0 the first term, plus cosine theta sine 90. Sine 90 is 1, so cosine of theta plus 90, therefore, is equal to cosine of theta. So that we can derive the formula for sigma y prime, or the normal stress in the y direction, y prime direction, or tangential to plane AA, or in the tangential direction. So sigma y prime is, we just substitute it here, sigma x cosine of theta plus 90, cosine of theta plus 90 is negative sine theta. So cosine of theta plus 90 is negative sine theta square, so it becomes sine squared theta. Then plus sigma y sine 9 theta plus 90 is, because the angle here is theta plus 90 degrees for this direction. So since sine of theta plus 90 is cosine theta, so if we replace this by theta plus 90, it becomes cosine theta quantity square. So that's why it's sigma y cosine square theta. Finally, sine theta plus 90 is cosine theta, and cosine theta plus 90 is negative sine theta, so the sine here becomes negative, and we have the same result, negative 2 tau xy sine theta cosine theta. Call that equation C. Then we call equations A through C as the stress transformation equations. These are the stress transformation equations. So recalling the transformation equation so that we can express the formulas in terms of trigonometric identities for double angles. So these were the transformation equations. Remember that cosine squared theta is 1 plus cosine 2 theta over 2. Then sine squared theta is equal to 1 minus cosine 2 theta over 2. And 2 sine theta cosine theta is sine 2 theta. So equation A becomes sigma x prime equals sigma x times quantity 1 plus cosine 2 theta over 2 plus sigma y. Then quantity 1 minus cosine 2 theta over 2. Then plus tau xy sine 2 theta. Sine 2 theta. Then simplifying further, we can now have this transformation equation, sigma x prime or sigma normal. Normal stress is equal to quantity sigma x plus sigma y over 2. Plus quantity sigma y, sigma x minus sigma y over 2 cosine theta from here, then plus tau xy sine 2 theta. Call this equation 8.5a. Then from equation C, sigma y prime or sigma t normal is equal to sigma x times 1 minus cosine 2 theta over 2 plus sigma y quantity 1 plus cosine 2 theta over 2 then minus tau xy sine 2 theta. Simplifying, you have sigma x, sigma y prime or sigma t, sigma nt or sigma t is equal to sigma x plus sigma y over 2 minus quantity sigma x minus sigma y over 2 cosine 2 theta minus tau xy sine 2 theta. Call that equation 8.b. And finally, from equation B, This becomes sine to theta over 2. So tau x prime y prime or tau nt is equal to negative of quantity sigma x minus sigma y over 2 sine to theta. Sine 2 theta over 2 plus tau xy quantity. This is cosine 2 theta. Cos cos minus sin sin. Or double angle. Simplifying, tau x prime y prime or tau nt is negative of quantity sigma x minus sigma y over 2 sine 2 theta plus tau xy cosine of 2 theta. So adding equations 8.5a and 8.5b reveal that we can cancel these two terms, and this the last two terms in the right side of the equation, sigma x plus y over 2 plus sigma x plus y over 2 would be sigma x plus sigma y. So sigma x prime plus sigma y prime is equal to sigma x plus sigma y equals sigma n plus sigma t. So that means the normal stresses on different planes do not change or invariant. Principal stresses and principal planes. So we now use these equations here to locate the critical section, or to locate the plane where principal stresses are found. When you say principal stresses, where we have the maximum normal and minimum normal stresses and the maximum shearing stress, and the corresponding location of these planes would be called principal planes. So the maximum and minimum normal stresses at a point are called principal stresses at that point. The planes on which the principal stresses act are referred to as the principal planes. The directions that are perpendicular to the principal planes are called the principal directions. So for maximizing the normal stresses, we differentiate this normal stress and equate to zero by calculus. So derivative of sigma x prime with respect to theta is, this is zero, this is quantity sigma x minus sigma y over 2. Derivative cosine is negative sine 2 theta times 2, then plus tau xy derivative of sine 2 theta is cosine 2 theta times 2. And we create to 0, cancel 2. Then we have sigma x minus sigma y times sine over 2 times sine 2 theta equals tau xy cosine 2 theta. So that means tangent to theta is 2 tau xy over quantity sigma x minus sigma y. Or you may denote this tangent to theta p, where p is the subscript means principal axis or principal stresses, principal plane. So equation 8.7 yields two solutions for two theta that differ by 180 degrees. If one solution is 2 theta 1, the second solution is 2 theta 2, which is equal to 2 theta 1 plus 180 degrees. So this will be geometrically presented on the next slides. Hence, the two principal directions differ by 90 degrees. So if one solution is 2 theta 1, the second solution is 2 theta 2, which is equal to 2 theta 1 plus 180 degrees. So hence, the two principal directions differ by 90 degrees. So remember that tangent to theta and tangent to theta plus 180 degrees have the same values. So for example, tangent of 210, tangent of 30 degrees, which is square root of 3 over 3, is also equal to tangent of 30 plus 180, which is square root of 3 over 3. So I hope you know that from trigonometry. So the sines and cosines, 2 theta 1 and 2 theta 2, or 2 theta p1 and 2 theta p2, can be obtained from the right triangle in this figure here as our guide. So sine of 2 theta 1 is opposite, which is plus minus tau xy over r, where r is square root of this quantity here, sigma x minus sigma y over 2 square plus tau xy quantity square. So, and cosine 2 theta 1, cosine 2 theta 2 would be plus minus sigma x minus sigma y over 2 over r, where r is, as I already explained, quantity sigma x minus sigma y over 2 square plus tau xy square from this right triangle. So substituting equations 8.8 and 8.9 into equation 8.5a, and simplifying, we obtain the principal stresses sigma 1 equal to sigma x plus sigma y over 2 plus r, because this is r, and sigma 2 is sigma x plus sigma y over 2 minus r for the sign, where sigma 1 and sigma 2 act on the planes defined by theta 1 and theta 2, or theta p1 and theta 2 respectively. Note that in equation 8.10, defines sigma 1 to be the larger of the principal stresses, that is sigma 1 is greater than sigma 2, but it doesn't mean that it is always true. For the absolute values, there might be a possibility that the absolute value of sigma 2 is greater than that of sigma 1, especially if both stresses, normal stresses, are in compression. But if one is in tension, the other is in compression, so if sigma 1 is tension and sigma 2 is in compression, then of course the magnitude of sigma 1 is greater. The sigma 1 is greater because it is in the right side than sigma 2. So the shear stresses acting on the principal planes are obtained by substituting equations 8.8, these two here, into equation 8.5c. The result would be tau 21 would be negative of sigma x minus sigma y over 2, then plus minus sine 2 theta, which is tau xy over r, plus minus tau xy over r, plus tau xy cosine of 2 theta, which is sigma x minus sigma y over 2 over r. And since these two will yield 0, so it means that there are no shear stresses on the principal planes. So to geometrically show that, these are the three different cases for biaxial stress. So this is sigma 1, the corresponding shear stress is 0. Sigma 2, the corresponding shear stress is 0. In this case, the absolute value of sigma 2 is greater than the absolute value of sigma 1. But sigma 1 is greater than sigma 2 without absolute value bars. Then if sigma 1 is in tension, sigma 2 is in compression, sigma 1 is greater than sigma 2 in this case. And take note that shear stress, corresponding shear stress, is 0 on this principal plane. Then case 3, sigma 1 is still greater than sigma 2. They have the same signs. By the way, in the first case, we have the same signs. Both are negative. In the second case, sigma 1 is positive tension and sigma 2 is in compression. And in the third case, both are in tension. So take note that the corresponding shearing stress at these principal values, principal stresses, 0. So that's the meaning of this result here. So the sines and cosines of 2 theta 1 and 2 theta 2 can be obtained from right triangle shown. So sine 2 theta 1, sine 2 theta 2 is plus minus tau xy over r. Cosine 2 theta 1, cosine theta 2 plus minus sigma x minus sigma y over 2 over r. Where r is, with this right triangle, the hypotenuse is the square root of the square of this quantity plus the square of that quantity. So substituting equations 8.8 and 8.9 into equation 8.5a in the preceding slides and simplifying, we obtain the principal stresses sigma 1 equals sigma x plus sigma y over 2 plus r. So in this equation, and this is r, and sigma 2 would be sigma x plus sigma y over 2 minus r, this one. Where sigma 1 and sigma 2 normal stresses at 1 and 2 act on the planes defined by theta 1 and theta 2 respectively. Note that in equation 8.10 defines sigma 1 to be larger of the principal stresses, that is sigma 1 is greater than equal to sigma 2. But if we put absolute value bars, sigma 1 may be less than equal to absolute value of sigma 1 may be less than equal to the absolute value of sigma 2. Because this will be the different situations, especially if both normal stresses are in compression. So the shear stresses acting on the principal planes are obtained by substituting equations 8.8 into equations 8.5. The result would be tau 1 2, tau 2 1 would be negative quantity sigma x minus sigma y over 2 times sine 2 theta, which is this one, plus tau xy cosine 2 theta. And because these are like and opposite sine terms, the result is zero. So it shows that there are no shear stresses on the principal planes. That's why we have to show it here. This is the geometric interpretation that sigma 1, the partner of this principal stress, sigma 1 is zero shear stress, sigma 2 zero shear stress. Both compression, in this case, sigma 1 is tension, sigma 2 is compression, so there are no shearing stress. Also, in this third case, sigma 1 and sigma 2 are both in tension, no shearing stress at these values there. So let us summarize everything so far by means of this biaxial state of stress and the drawings as guides. So in this case, this is the free body diagram, this portion. I denoted here dA to be equal to 1 so that by means of the free body diagram method, we can easily develop the formulas or equations of statics without memorizing the transformation equations so far. Because one way of computing the normal and the tangential component of stresses would be the free body diagram method. And remember, we cannot compute or locate yet the critical section once the transformation equations are not yet derived. So once the transformation equations are derived and memorized, then we can locate the critical section. And the result was tangent 2 theta or tangent 2 theta p defined in equation 8.7 is equal to 2 times tau xy over quantity sigma x minus sigma y. That's the formula that we should remember. And for sigma 1, sigma p1, it is sigma x minus sigma y over 2 plus r. And sigma y prime or sigma normal stress tangential is sigma x minus sigma y over 2 minus r, where r is square root of quantity sigma x minus sigma y over 2 square plus tau xy square. So this is the guide. So we have the positive sigma x minus sigma y over 2. This is sigma x minus sigma y over 2. These are positive. By the way, these are the positive normal and shearing stresses. Opposite to this direction should be their negatives. And this is, this hypotenuse is square root of sigma x minus sigma y over 2 quantity square plus tau xy quantity square, which were denoted by R, capital R. So again, sigma x prime is, this was derived already, discussed and repeated here, sigma y prime and sigma y prime in trigonometric form, and tau x prime y prime, this is the formula, tau x prime y prime or tau nt, negative of sigma x minus sigma y over 2 sine 2 theta plus tau xy cosine 2 theta. And this was the result when we add equations 8.5a and equation 8.5b. The normal stresses, the sum of the normal stresses in perpendicular directions do not change or invariant. Then tangent to theta p, tangent to theta is 2 times tau xy over sigma x minus sigma y. In locating the principal planes or in computing the principal stresses. So three important facts about stresses that were developed, especially in chapter 1. The maximum normal stress for a centric tensile or compressive load in one direction is in the direction of the load on the plane normal to the load, and its magnitude is, normal stress is P over A, if you can recall. The maximum shearing stress for centric tensile or compressive load in one direction is on a plane at an angle of 45 degrees to the load, and its magnitude is maximum normal stress divided by 2, or P over 2A, if you can recall. And of course, you have to recall the formula also. Sigma in general is P over A cosine squared theta, and tau shearing stress is P over 2A sine 2 theta, if you can recall. That's why the angle between the maximum, between the planes of maximum normal stress and maximum shear stress is 45 degrees. For all types of loads, a shearing stress at any one point on any plane is accompanied by a shearing stress of equal magnitude on an orthogonal plane through the point or same point. So once the normal and shearing stress on orthogonal planes through a point in the body are known, the normal and shearing stresses on any specific plane through the same point can be obtained by the free body diagram method. But this method is limited. We cannot tell the location of critical section. So that's why we need the reinforcement of the transformation equations, because the maximum tensile and compressive stresses and the maximum shearing stresses are the critical stresses and therefore determined by means of the transformation equations. And the important equation in locating the principal in computing the principal stresses and the principal directions would be tangent 2 theta p, equation 8.7, equals 2 times tau xy over sigma x minus sigma y. And it was geometrically presented in the preceding slide for your guide, for our guide. So for the summary of sign conventions for stresses, recall the figure in the preceding slides. Tensile normal stresses are positive, compressive normal stresses are negative. All of the normal stresses shown on the figure in the preceding slide are positive. A shearing stress is positive if it points in the positive direction of the coordinate axis of the second subscript when it is acting on a surface whose outward normal is in a positive direction. Similarly, if the outward normal of the surface is in a negative direction, then a positive shearing stress points in the negative direction of the coordinate axis of the second subscript. All of the shearing stresses shown on the figure in the preceding slides are positive. An angle measured counterclockwise from the reference x-axis is positive. Of course, if it's clockwise, conversely, it will be negative. The NTZ axis have the same order as the XYZ axis. Both sets of axes form a right-hand coordinate system. So that's it, and we are ready to compute state of stress on any other plane, oblique from the reference plane. So that's the first step without yet locating the critical section or computing the principal stresses and the principal directions. So we'll just use the free body diagram method first to compute the stresses on passing on any other plane through the same point.